I told you I don't want the press over here. Hello. I want you away from me.
Because this is the place, the precise area where Jesus preached the Sermon on the Mount. And you can well imagine how that took place, because this is this from time immemorial has been a lovely spot to look out over the Lake of Galilee. In the days before the destruction of Israel, this was heavily, we know from certain things we found, this was heavily wooded, so it was a beautiful area filled with wildflowers and trees and things and so forth. What you see here, this commemorative church, it's in a holy place. It's not especially holy to me. Mussolini built it. I think he was trying to do penance when he built that. But the important thing is what happened here. Can you hear me back there? No, I'm speaking the direction. The important thing is what happened here, because it was at this place that Jesus preached his first major public message. And it is beautiful because it reflects the character of God. However, I would venture to say the Sermon on the Mount is the most misunderstood message in the Bible. I listen to ministers talking about it frequently on radio, on television, and I absolutely wince. Sometimes I shrink back in agony because I realize how much pain can be brought to people by not understanding the purpose of this message. Let's take a look at it. And first of all, I think it's important to see to whom it was given and why that was important. Now, you've all got your place. Here's mine. Let's see. Matthew chapter 5, verse 1. And when he saw the multitudes, he went up on the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Now, you have to realize there was this great multitude. They followed Jesus everywhere he went. He had already done miracles in Capernaum. He had done miracles in Cana. The word about him was spreading everywhere. So by the time he gave this message, he had become a phenomenon in this land. People were beginning to say, a prophet like this has not arisen since the ancient times. Even here is one like Moses. And so they were beginning to suspect, is this a Messiah? And yet, the most difficult thing began to happen, and that is the Jewish rabbis, the Jewish religious leaders, began to dispute with him and began to confuse the people. You have to realize that Judaism, then as now, taught that the only way to be saved is by keeping the law of Moses. And so when Jesus came, and he said, I have come to be your Savior. I've come to die for your sins. They said, oh, we don't have any sins. We keep the law. We don't need a Savior. And they felt that the animal sacrifices covered whatever little mistake they might make here or there. So they actually began to cover and distort the message. So why Jesus preaches this message is brought out very quickly. They said they didn't need an atonement for their sin beyond what was already there, because they thought they were right before God because they kept the law of Moses. In fact, they looked down on the Gentiles as dogs, as those without light, those who were hopelessly lost in sin because they didn't have the law. So it's to people who thought that way that Jesus gave this message. He had his disciples sit closest to him, but the crowd, of course, came and filled in. So Jesus really spoke this message more than anything to the religious leaders, to those who were teaching the people that they were saved by keeping the law. Now, in the light of that, he begins to show in the Beatitudes, as they're called, he begins to show what is the most important thing to God. And as you look through these, you'll find that these are all talking about, what in the world is that? These are all talking about inner characteristics. The Beatitudes talk about things that are not just ritualistic keeping of rules. It talks about mercy. It talks about gentleness. It talks about having an attitude of being a peacemaker and so forth. These are all characteristics, by the way, that automatically are produced in the Christian today when he is filled with the Holy Spirit. By that I mean by your will, by your faith, you're under the control of the Holy Spirit. So that is the natural outcome of a person who is filled with the Spirit. The Beatitudes, however, were focusing on what was lacking in the people who were living under the ritualistic rules of Judaism. And so after he first gives the positive things that God looks for in a character, then he takes up the very thing that they cherished. Here were the people who said they knew everything there was to know about the law of Moses. Here were the people who said, and by the way, they had volumes that were written on the meaning of the law of Moses. They had an oral tradition that had been passed down for several centuries, many centuries. So they felt they knew everything there was to know already about what the law meant. And so it's to that kind of group that Jesus begins to give this message. Look at verse 17. Do not think that I came to abolish the law of the prophets. I did not come to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not the smallest letter or stroke shall pass away from the law until all is accomplished. Whoever then annuls one of the least of these commandments and so teaches others shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever keeps and teaches them, he shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. What he is doing here is he is showing that what he is about to say is not contrary to the law. As a matter of fact, he says, not the smallest stroke. A jot and a tittle would be like dot of an I and crossing a T to us today. In other words, not even a part of a letter will be removed from the law until all of it is fulfilled. Now, hold your place here, and I want to put this out of the way right away. Hold your place and turn to Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10, verses 1 through 4. Brethren, my heart's desire and my prayer to God for them. Who's he speaking about? The Jews, Israel. My prayer to God for them is for their salvation. For I bear them witness that they have a zeal for God, but not in accordance with knowledge. You know, this is why I shock people sometime when I say, hell is going to be filled with sincere people. Because sincerity saves no one. You can be sincerely wrong. And unfortunately, most people wrapped up in religion are sincerely wrong. And they believe they're right. But what does Paul say here? He says, I pray for them. He agonized. He said he could even wish, if it were possible, that he were accursed from Christ if it would save his brethren. His brethren according to the flesh. And so, you know, he was concerned for them, but he says, I pray for their salvation. For they have a knowledge of God, but they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. In other words, they thought they knew all about how to find God, how to know him, but he says it's not according to knowledge. They had no understanding. And so he says, for not knowing about God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own, They did not subject themselves to the righteousness of God. What was their problem? The first and the foremost thing is they did not know about the thing they thought they knew most about, the righteousness of God. Now, how could not knowing about God's righteousness be their greatest failing? Well, frankly, it's not just the problem of Israel. It's the problem today, too. Because it's man is born with a congenital blindness to how righteous God is. Now, what do I mean by that? He is born with a congenital blindness to the fact that God is so righteous that no amount of our good deeds will ever qualify us to be in His presence. God is so righteous that our efforts, no matter how sincere, of trying to keep the law of Moses as a way of coming to Him is impossible. Impossible. And so the one who does the same thing as the Pharisees did is just as blind as they are. It is to this that Jesus preached the Sermon on the Mount. But let's read on. He says, not knowing about God's righteousness, seeking to establish their own. How? By trying to keep the law. They did not subject themselves to the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. That is the good news. Isn't that good news? He is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. In other words, the moment you believe that Jesus died in your place and He died and paid the penalty for every time you fall short of God's righteousness in thought, word, and deed, the moment you believe that, then He gives you a righteousness that is clothed upon you like a cloak. And it is not one that you can produce ever. It is the righteousness that He purchased at the cross for you. It is His own righteousness. It's as if He takes off His own mantle of righteousness and clothes you completely in it so that God no longer sees you in your weaknesses. He sees you wrapped in the righteousness of His own Son. And that's the only reason any of us are ever acceptable. Now, it is verse 4 that you must connect with Matthew 5:17. What does it say? For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. All right, now look at Matthew 5:17. Hold your place there and look at Matthew 5:17. Do not think that I came to abolish the law or the prophets. I did not come to abolish, but to fulfill. Now the question is, did He fulfill the law? Yes. He fulfilled it for us. And therefore, He becomes the end of the law for each one of us the moment we believe in Him. You are under the law until you believe in Him. The law demands perfect obedience. And just in case you think that you can make it, let me show you, God doesn't grade on the curve on your law keeping. Because James chapter 2, verse 10 says, whosoever keeps the whole law, yet offends in one point, is what? Guilty of all of it. Now, if you understand that, you'll understand why Jesus preached the Sermon on the Mount. And I hope and I pray that when I get through with this message this morning, none of you will be so foolish as to ever say, I'm a Christian because I keep the Sermon on the Mount. Now, I hear people say this all the time. I hear ministers every Sunday preach, the way of the Christian life is to keep the Sermon on the Mount. God help us. The Sermon on the Mount is the greatest hellfire and damnation sermon ever preached because none of us can come close to it. We can walk in the Spirit and have the fruit of the Spirit produced in us. And Romans 8 says that He produces the righteousness of the law in us who do not walk according to the flesh, which means your human efforts, but according to the Spirit, which means you're depending on the supernatural power of the Holy Spirit to work through you. But The law is not a way of salvation, and it is not the way of the Christian life either. Nor is the Sermon on the Mount. If it were, we'd all be damned. Now, in that light, let's look at it. Look at verse 20. For I say to you, that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you shall not enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, who was sitting in the audience? The scribes and the Pharisees. This is a way to influence and win friends, I'll tell you. You see, Jesus had more guts, just as a human. Of course, he was God and man in one person. But he walked as a man while he was here on this earth. And he was exposed to all the danger of a man. And yet he had the courage to say to the face of these religious teachers who had murder in their heart if they were challenged on their religious pride. He had the nerve to stand up and say, unless your righteousness exceeds those guys' righteousness, you'll never enter the kingdom of heaven. That's the sort of thing you would say to the leaders of the World Council of Churches, because theirs will never make it either. But you see, what is he saying here? It's very important. What did the scribes and Pharisees do? A Pharisee had to memorize the Old Testament in Hebrew. Memorize it. All of it. They gave twice a year 10% of everything they owned. So that's 20% a year they gave to the temple. They prayed 7 times a day. If they were in Jerusalem, they sought to be at the temple 3 times a day for prayer. They, as far as Paul bears witness of his own righteousness as a Pharisee in Philippians chapter 3, he said, as touching the law, his life was blameless as far as man could see. So what is Jesus about to do here? Well, let's see. Look at verse 21. You have heard that the ancients were told, you shall not commit murder. Now, I'm reading from the New American Standard Bible, which is a very, very accurate translation, and that's what it should be. Unfortunately, the King James never made a distinction between kill and murder. So let me correct that right now. There's a vast difference between murder and kill. How do I know that? The law of Moses never taught passivism. You know, there's some people that get out of military service because they say the law teaches that you should never kill under any circumstances. That's passivism. But if you'll read the law, what does it say? They were commanded to kill the killers. They were commanded to stone to death the one who murdered. Why? Because there's a vast difference between a just cause and one who wantonly took another's life, which is murder. Well, we're talking about murder here. And so he says, you have heard that the ancients were told, you shall not murder. Now, who are the ancients he's talking about here? All of the great rabbis. All of the great rabbis of history. He uses a word here in the Greek, and it's the translation of the word from the Aramaic Hebrew, which meant the great sages of the rabbis. So what he is saying is, you've heard that all of the great rabbis taught, you shall not murder. What's he doing here? He is about to take issue with all of the great teachers of Judaism. Now, when he did this, he knew he was sealing his own death warrant. He knew that from the moment he opened his mouth here, it's only a matter of time before they would kill him. Because he's taking issue with the greatest teachers in the history of Israel. But here he goes. You have heard that the great sages, let's put it the way it should be, the great sages were told, you shall not commit murder, and whoever commits murder shall be liable to the court. But I say to you. Now, what is he doing? He is asserting divine authority here. He is saying, I have more authority than all of the teachers in the history of Israel. So he says, but I say to you. This is what it means. Now, he goes on to explain. I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother shall be guilty before the court. Whoever shall say to his brother, Raka, which was a, a word of utter contempt. Raca shall be guilty before the Supreme Court. Whoever shall say, you fool, one even of greater contempt, shall be guilty enough to go into the fiery hell. So, what is he saying here? He is beginning to show what the law meant. Here are these people who thought they kept the law perfectly. They thought they were saved by keeping the law. Now what he says, but I say, if you're angry with your brother, you'll be judged for murder before the courts. Before what court? The court of God. So what's he doing here? He's taking it from external observance of the law to the heart and the motives of the heart. You see, that's the difference between religion and Christianity. Religion judges the outward observance. Jesus called it cleaning up the outside of the platter, but not the inside. And you know, by great effort and human pride, we can clean up the outside pretty well. I see people in churches all over the place who've cleaned up the outside by their own efforts. There'll always be something that goes along with that. A very arrogant spiritual pride. There's one kind of person I know will never be in heaven, and that's a spiritually proud person. They're not going to be there. Everyone who stands before Christ will fall on his face and say, I'm only here because of your grace, not because of anything I've ever done. So what Jesus is doing here, he shows, I love to hear those birds here. Jesus is showing that the law is not just judged by outward observance, but God looks at the heart. And keeping the law, as far as God is concerned, has to do more with your attitude and your motive than it does with the outward observance. So what Jesus is saying, look, if you've ever been angry without cause at anyone, you're guilty of breaking this commandment. You have broken the commandment, you shall not murder. Because in God's sight, that anger is what causes murder. And if it were not curbed by society, it would result in murder. So that is what God views. Now let's look at another one. Verse 27. You have heard that it was said, and again he's referring to the great teachers of history of Israel, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks on a woman to lust for her has committed adultery with her already in his heart. Now, here are these proud teachers. They say, we've never murdered. And boy, he's just wiped that one out. He shows they've broken that commandment because they were breaking it while he was saying it because they were furious at him. And they would have killed him if they could have right there. Now he hits them with another. Notice, he doesn't say about the woman. He's hitting the men. He says, you have heard it taught, you shall not commit adultery. But I say, if you look after a woman with lust, you've committed adultery in your heart already. Boom! Right in the heart, you got them. I remember when I was a tugboat captain in New Orleans, and I was raised without any religion. I was raised, as I've always said, a devout pagan. And yet, when I reached the point in my life where I had partied my way almost into oblivion, I used to come in from, you know, I had a week on and a week off as tugboat captain. So when I'd hit New Orleans, I'd go to my apartment in the French Quarter, and I mean, to me, that was the ultimate. I'd have a full paycheck. I had plenty of girlfriends, no problems, plenty of money. I knew that I didn't have to save a penny because when I was on duty, they completely took care of me. So I figured I had seven glorious days to party. And the first 72 hours, every time I'd come in, I wouldn't sleep. I mean, literally go 72 hours without a break. Then I'd sleep a few hours and take off again. I mean, I was a wild man. And others would look on in awe at my propensity for sin. But I came to a point in my life where I said, what do you do for an encore? I mean, there was such emptiness. I'd done it all by the time I was 25. And I started searching for God. I took Catholic instruction. I didn't find anything there that was of interest. I went to a Baptist church, and I said, now I know why I hated these people, and I walked out. And I went to different places, and I couldn't find anyone who gave the gospel. So finally, I sat down and started reading the Bible. I had a New Testament that I carried as a rabbit's foot. I thought it was good luck. I never read it, but I thought it was good luck, so I always carried it. I'd been given to Gideon had given it to me when I was 12 years old, and I'd been carrying it all that time and never read it. So when I started reading, I came through the Sermon on the Mount. And of course, as I read it, I had no idea what it meant. And as I was reading it, I began to look at this, and of course, I had a real temper. I got in fights all the time. So when I looked at that about murder, I've had it. And when I read this about adultery, I almost closed the book and put it away because I realized I hadn't just been thinking it. But then I stopped, and it was on this particular verse that I stopped and thought, now wait a minute. I know I've had it, if this is the way that you have to be to find God. But I said, frankly, I can't remember one man that can say he's never lusted after a woman. Because there is a nature in us, and I knew about the nature of sin. I didn't know anything about other things, but I knew about that. I knew that that was part of man. Well, I had met a few, but they had another problem. They lived in San Francisco. Now, it was here that the Holy Spirit began to deal with me. And you know, the Holy Spirit was using the law the way it should be used, to convict. That's the purpose of the law, to convict you, to shut up every possibility in your thinking that somehow you can be good enough to qualify with God. And boy, I mean, you know, I knew I'd had it, so I kept on reading. Well, I read through Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and I got in the third chapter of the Gospel of John. I said, hey, this reads like a different book. And it was black and white. He that believes on the Son has everlasting life. He who doesn't believe shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides upon him. I said, well, that's easy. I can understand that. This is not talking about he who is a Catholic has eternal life, or he who is a Baptist has eternal life, or he who is an Episcopalian has. It says he who believes in Jesus, which was the issue. And the Holy Spirit showed me that all alone on tugboat. And then I said, Lord, how do I find this? How do I come to know you? If you're real, and I think you must be, I said to myself, if you're real, then how do I come to believe in you? And I flipped to the back of that New Testament I had, and it says, if you've made a decision to receive Jesus Christ, here's how you do it. And it explained. And I went through, and it said, now sign your name and date it. I signed my name and dated it. I still have that Bible. But the point was, the beginning of salvation for me as a rank pagan was seeing these verses and the Holy Spirit using the law lawfully, using the law the way it should be used to so convict people of their complete fallenness that every way of human effort to see God is shut off. And that's why I say, I hear people use the Sermon on the Mount, they air condition hell with it. They make it seem that you can keep this. You can't keep it. The whole purpose of this was to show the impossibility of keeping the law. What is the Sermon on the Mount? It is the divine interpretation of what the law really means. That's what it is. And it's Jesus himself who shows what it means. Now, he goes on to say many other things. I'll just take up one more. verse 43. You have heard it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Now, this really convicted me. Because as I was reading through this, you know, only the Holy Spirit could have taught me the things that I learned that day. I realized that. I realized no man led me to Christ. It was the Holy Spirit. But he used the Word of God. And I guess that's why I've always loved the Word of God so much from the day I was born spiritually. But when I read this, I realized in my own heart that I use people, that I didn't love them. Even the girls I thought I loved, I used them, I exploited them. And the Holy Spirit convicted me of that. And the important thing that I got out of this was that if we're really honest with ourselves, who do we really love before the Holy Spirit gives us the ability to love truly? Well, I mean, we can have a love for our mother, our father, but even that is a sort of a if kind of love. It has qualifications to it. It has ways of exploiting. And so as I read this, I realized, hey, there is no way that I'm going to pray for my enemies. There's no way that I'm not going to take revenge. I'm Apache. And Apaches, if it takes them 20 years, they'll get even with you. And I had some of that in me. And so when I read this verse, I realized there was no possibility for me to know God if this was the way of salvation. But you see, the group to whom Jesus was speaking, or to whom Jesus was speaking here, they thought they had the law nailed. And when he gives this last commandment, that is the most important of all, because it was not really part of the Ten Commandments. You shall love your neighbor as yourself was a summary of all the commandments. Jesus himself said that. So he throws this in at the end and he says, you've heard that it was said you shall love your enemy, or love your neighbor and hate your enemy, but I say love your enemy. Now if you read the Old Testament, you read the Torah, you'll find that in the Torah it says love your neighbor as yourself. It never once says hate your enemy. Where'd that come from? It was added by the rabbis. But that was part of their religious tradition. And so Jesus takes that head on. You see, they had to find a way to get themselves off the hook. Because they knew they didn't love their enemies. They certainly knew they didn't love someone outside. That's why Jesus gave the parable of the Good Samaritan. He shows that, you know, the Levite, who was a Levite? He was a priest. He was supposed to be a minister. And what does he do? He sees this man injured and wounded lying on the side of the road, and he says, a Levite came by, and he walked over on the other side of the street so he wouldn't have to see it, and he walked on by and didn't help him. And he says another, a rabbi came by, and he walked by and didn't help him. And then he says, a Samaritan came by. Who was a Samaritan? They were considered half-breed outcasts. And Jesus said the Samaritan went over and he poured medicine on him. He put him on his own animal. He carried him to an inn. He gave them money to take care of him. And he says, if he needs anything else when I come back, I will pay it. And he says, now which one was the neighbor? He says, what was he doing? He was showing what it meant to love your neighbor as yourself. And this is what they didn't do. And yet Jesus said in another place, a man came to him, he was one of the great teachers of the law. He said, which is the great commandment? Which is the greatest commandment? Jesus said, the greatest commandment is to love your neighbor as yourself, to love God. Well, first of all, he said, is to love God with all your heart, soul, and your mind. And the second is like it, to love your neighbor as yourself. He said, on these two hangs all the law and the prophets. Well, that's what Jesus was nailing down here. So to me, this is a very precious place because it was here that Jesus began to clarify that which man always obscures. Man always tries to find a way, and I mean you girls too, speaking generically here. Man always tries to find a way to slip in human qualifications or human merit. And you know, it doesn't stop after you're born again. Even after we're born again, we still try to live the Christian life by human merit system. And it is so important that we realize the Christian life is not difficult, it's impossible. It cannot be lived by human effort. But it can be lived by a moment by moment dependence upon the Holy Spirit. The Sermon on the Mount should teach us the impossibility of trying to live for God either before or after we know Jesus Christ by our own human strength, by our own human effort. It is a supernatural way of life that requires a supernatural means of power. Anything less is not the Christian life. And so, this is what I feel is one of the most important messages you'll ever hear that I will ever know, is to learn that God wants to crush in us the efforts that we make to follow the law. He wants to crush in us this idea that somehow we can do it ourselves. We're shut up to dependence upon the Holy Spirit. It's our only hope to live a life that's pleasing to God. Now, there are all kinds of counterfeits. You will see people doing all kinds of things as Christians and call it the Christian life, but it is not. The Christian life is not anything that you can do. The Christian life is what the Holy Spirit can empower you to do as you trust Him. Now, that's why I hope I'll have another chance to go through Romans chapter 7 with you. Romans chapter 7 is a picture of Paul himself trying to live as a believer under the law. I call it Christian schizophrenia, because Paul says that he was alive apart from the law, and then the law came and he died. What does that mean? He died operationally. He died in his fellowship with God. He didn't lose his salvation, but when the law came along, it caused him to lose his fellowship and that beautiful relationship that brings peace, and it brings productivity in your life. It brings love, it brings joy, it brings inner security, inner happiness. You know, when you've had it and you lose it, you really know it. There's nothing more, or it should be, there's nothing more heart-rending than a believer who has walked with God who gets out of fellowship. That should be the most unhappy thing in the world for a Christian. If you know what it is to walk in the Spirit, if you know what it is to have that love of God flow through you, to be able to have little everyday things hit you, like losing your bags, and to be able to rest in the Lord about it, to be able to have peace and know that God will take care of it, or to lose your money and know that somehow God allowed that. There's nothing that ever is allowed into our life that God didn't allow. And just to realize, why did this happen? I'll tell you why. To give you a glorious opportunity to claim a promise of God and crack the faith barrier and get on the other side of human experience, where there's no more of this inner turmoil, but there's peace and there's inner tranquility. And you know that whatever happens, God will take care of it. God will do it. And don't think, you know, you can get mature as a Christian. Don't think that you ever run out of glorious opportunities to trust the Lord. God hits me with them every day. I mean, I'm having to crack the faith barrier every day. Sometimes I go subsonic. But it's all the Lord's way. But we must learn what Paul meant when he says, the thing I want to do, I don't do. But I keep doing the things that I hate. And he says, oh, wretched man that I am, who'll deliver me from the body of this death? What was he saying? He was trying to live for God by keeping the law. You know, the law, God didn't give us the Holy Spirit for us to then go try to keep the law. What that does is cause the old sin nature to rebel again. The minute you set up the law, it causes your old sin nature that's still in you to rebel. And pretty soon you say, I don't understand. The things I want to do, I don't do. The things I hate, I keep on doing. Ever been there? We've all been there. Now, what God wants is for us to simply be in His Word, learn what sort of character do we to have. The character of God, the character of Christ is in here. The Holy Spirit takes the Word, puts it in our heart. He forms the pattern of a righteous character in our being. He put a new nature in us when we were born again, and that new nature absorbs the Word, and it causes us to want to do it. It causes us to want to be like the Lord shows us in the mirror, which is His Word. And so as the Holy Spirit, we depend on Him to fulfill these desires that come from this new nature. The Holy Spirit does produce this. And that's why the standard of life that we have is higher than the law. We don't need to put ourselves under the law. The Holy Spirit produces the righteousness of it without the written code. But it's done from in the heart. It's done from the Holy Spirit working in our new natures, causing us to want to desire what God wants. And then as we say yes to that, we say no to temptation, we depend on the Holy Spirit, He produces that. Well, I may labor that, but I feel like this is so important that we need to be reminded of it every day. I have to remind myself. Hey, I get over in the flesh every day. But what I'm trying to do is cut it off as much as I can. None of us will ever be perfect. But I want to spend, as we would say in the military, I want to log as much time in the Spirit as I can. I want to respond every day to more of the situations of life by immediately depending on Christ within me, depending on the Holy Spirit to do that. You'll always be tempted to have the wrong attitude and the wrong response. Say no to it, and then turn immediately in your heart to depending on the Holy Spirit. And as we keep doing that, we'll keep having the blessed Beatitudes fulfilled in us. Let us pray. Father, we thank You in Jesus' name for the way of life that Jesus began to spell out here. We thank You that what You have given us is higher than the law. What You have given us is more gracious. What You have given us is a way of hope and peace. What You have given us is the way of true righteousness. And Lord, right now we claim this blessed filling of the Spirit. May we walk moment by moment in dependence upon Him. May He produce the character of Christ in us. May the significance of this place bless all the people.
דורון, כן מותק. אה, Hi. Good to see you. He's in the coach car, yeah. Yes. 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 Yes.
We are carrying water all the way down to the Negev area, which is the desert of this country. If you want to see a fulfillment of a prophecy in the full sense of the word, one has to go down to the area south of Beersheba. Areas which were barren and empty and dry for many long centuries and are today becoming the breadbasket of Israel, thanks to the waters taken from the Sea of Galilee. The Bible talks about the blooming of the desert. That's where you're going to see it, this area around Beersheba. Because those 400 million cubic meters of water a year taken out from the lake actually saved an area which would have been a lost case if not for the waters which you see over here. The problem is that the Sea of Galilee is very much dependent on the amounts of rain coming down here, and therefore if it's a bad rainy season there is more water taken out of the lake than coming into it, and this is where we suffer the very bad drop of the water table. And that's exactly what happened during the last 3 years. Unfortunately, we were forced to cut budgets and amounts of water for farmers, and situation is not getting any better, up to the point that we are seriously thinking about carrying water all the way from Turkey for the needs in this country. The chain of mountains you see to your left-hand side, if you face the boat towards this direction, these are the Golan Heights. And those innocent-looking mountains until 1967 were the biggest threat for the existence of Israel, because until 1967 this old territory was Syria. And the Syrians took advantage of the fact that they were situated on top of the hills, where they found it very convenient and easy to station those heavy cannons pointed into major cities like Tiberias, pointed into most of the Israeli settlements which we had situated on the eastern shores of the Sea of Galilee, and to all the valleys like the Hula Valley, the Beit She'an Valley, and the Jordan Valley, which were always in reach of the heavy Syrian artillery. And this is what we had to live with for 19 years, between 1948 to 1967, not having one single day of peace in the area, until the Six Days War, when all those mountains have been taken over by Israel, and for the first time in so many years, all of a sudden a very unfamiliar silence came down to this area, something the people around here were not used to during those 19 years until 1967. People, we established on top of those mountains some 34 settlements. 34 settlements which brought life to an area of death. Settlements which replaced batteries of artillery, that replaced army camps. And I would not suggest anyone to be too naive. The fact that Israel established 34 settlements somewhere, it is in a way the best way to make a point that we intend to stay on those mountains and for good. Because for us, moving away from those mountains is a national committing of suicide. One can be flexible, one can be easy as far as compromises and as far as flexibility where it doesn't endanger its own existence. The day Israel moves away from those mountains is the very same day when the Syrians are going to be back. As there are no treaties and no guarantees and no references and no signatures of any superpower in the world or any world organization which can replace our being on those mountains. As long as Israel is on those mountains, the Syrians are not. The day we move back, they'll be back. And this is not a situation Israel would be willing to go back to, because we lived under this situation during the period of the 19 years, and it's not the way we would go back to bring up our children anymore. If you look straight ahead, you see like a narrow rift, like a valley, which is cutting across the mountains. Next to it, underneath, you see like a line of trees. Can you see it? Mm-hmm. People, this is the land of the Gadarenes. This was the area of the city of Gadara, which was one of the major cities of the people of the tribe of Gad. Remember, the people of Gad arrived to this area, led by Joshua, at the very end of the Exodus. They looked around and they said, well, listen, we like this territory. It's large, it's green, there's plenty of water. We don't want to go any farther. And they decided to settle in this area, and they chose the second best. And one does pay a price when he chooses the second best. Because it's true that those people inherited a beautiful piece of land, which is fertile, with plenty of water, and yet they were the farthest away from all the main Jewish centers of guidance and authority. They were far from Beit El, they were far from Shiloh, they were far from Jerusalem, and yet they were so close to the ancient Assyrians. And people, Syria of today are the ancient Assyrians of the Bible. They didn't change much, believe me. Being so exposed to the influence of paganism over here, being so close by to the Assyrians with their idolatry and the worship of idols, they definitely adapted a lot of the atmosphere around them, especially by as it was so far away from the Jewish centers of guidance. And therefore, those people of the tribe of Gad slowly, slowly integrated among the non-Jews and the pagans over here and simply lost their identity as Jews. And they just disappeared. They vanished. Because remember, Jesus is crossing the lake on his way to the land of the Gadarenes, the land of the people of Gadara, and there is this man who is a shepherd of what? Of swines, right? Believe me, if he would have been a practicing Jew, he would have not been no shepherd of no swines. He wouldn't even come close to a swine, right? He just showed you the amount of influence of paganism among the ones living over here in those days. Okay, the mountains which you see just ahead of you to the right, these are the mountains of the Lower Galilee. You can see very clearly this rock which stands out so perfectly. It looks like a table mountain. This is the rock of Arbel, or the mountains of Arbala, mentioned by the historian Josephus to be the place where the Jews hid out in the caves in the war against the army of Herod the Great, when Herod the Great was still the governor of the Galilee before he became king of the rest of Judea. Josephus describes how many of those people hiding in the caves threw themselves down into the valleys, committing suicide, preferring to die than to be caught by the armies of Herod, who were known to be so cruel. I would not suggest any of you to be deceived by this very calm-looking sort of lake, because this lake can turn into a rough ocean within minutes, especially in the afternoons, because of the topography of where this lake is situated. You are actually in a sort of a crater, surrounded by mountains all around, with one exception, and this is the area towards the south, where the outlet of the Jordan is, where some of you guys are going to be baptized today. When the winds began to blow from the Mediterranean, from the west, if you pay attention, in this range of mountains are narrow valleys, which are known as the wadis. A wadi is a dry river, which is being filled up with water only in the wintertime. In the summer, it's completely dry. Those wadis, those riverbeds, are actually turning into air tunnels for the wind which began blowing from the Mediterranean. The wind blows across the wadi and hits the body of water with tremendous force in a way that you can take out in a calm day like today in a beautiful calm lake like today, on a boat, and all of a sudden you face waves which are sometimes frightening to look at. You can ask Doron, you can ask Al. We have been on real storms on this lake, let me tell you. The people which were here were praying in every language they could. Everyone sitting with their life jackets and stuff, and it can be quite frightening to see a storm on the Lake of Galilee. And again, here we come back to what the Bible describes about the sudden storm which began on the lake when Jesus and Peter were here on the day of fishing, because it's a very common phenomenon to come across any of those storms, summer and winter. So here we are, surrounded by the beautiful terrain of the Galilee, the very same sight, the very same view, the very same hills, the very same valleys that Jesus and his generation would have faced with their very eyes.
And the most vicious enemy that Israel has is Syria. They absolutely are bloody murderers when they get up on those hills. And James Baker doesn't seem to know this. We really need to pray for Israel right now, because he's putting all kinds of pressure on Israel and circulating back and forth to Cairo and so forth and to Damascus, because these guys are playing the diplomatic game now, because they think he can twist Israel's arm to give up the West Bank and to give up these hills here. And either one would mean the destruction of Israel. I don't think they should give up one square meter, because the whole idea of land for peace has been tried over and over again. It's never worked. I mean, let's start with Hitler, when he said, you know, my complete demands will be satisfied when the territory in Czechoslovakia is given, and when Sudetenland was given to him. Well, each one was given. They gave him the whole country of Czechoslovakia without even checking with the president of Czechoslovakia. And like always, tyrants never are satisfied. They take every concession as a sign of weakness. And so we need to really pray that our State Department will have a baptism of whatever it takes, fire or intelligence or whatever, to leave this alone over here, because it's not going to cause peace. Giving up land will never cause peace. But let's talk about something else that's very important that happened around here. You see Capernaum over here, and you see that was the main Jewish town of the time. Tiberias was a Roman town. They didn't go there, but they did a great number of miracles in and around Capernaum. And Jesus also loved to walk around the shore of the lake to the various settlements that were there in that time. And there he performed great miracles. But in spite of that, Chorazin was another place that the ruins are just up the mountain from Capernaum. They're just excavating them now. But those were the two cities where he did most of his miracles. And yet, do you know what? Most of the people there didn't believe. You know, you talk to people today, and most Christians think, if I just saw a physical miracle that Jesus did, I would really believe that. No, you wouldn't. Most of us wouldn't. Because Jesus presents physical miracles as baby rattlers for babies. That's not the best way to have a faith founded. And I'm afraid that the whole idea of faith in Christianity today has been turned upside down. You got people who will travel over hill and dale to go to some miracle working meeting, and because it's sort of a religious sideshow in many cases. But they wouldn't go around the block to see somebody converted to Christ. Many wouldn't. You know, Jesus said about this place here, he warned Chorazin, and he warned Capernaum. He said if the miracles had been done in Sodom and Gomorrah that had been done there, it would have been converted in sackcloth and ashes long before. But he pronounced judgment on those cities, and they were later destroyed. But the nature of what Jesus is seeking in us, I think, is appropriate to look at here on this very place where he did most of the miracles. In John chapter 4, a high official from Capernaum came to him when he was in Cana and wanted him to come down and heal his son. The response that Jesus made to him is most important. Of course, he did heal his son. In fact, he healed him with a word. And he told the man, now go home. He was a day's journey away.
he said, go home, your son lives. And the next day, the man checked when he got home, and he checked the hour when his son got well, and it was the exact time that Jesus had said, your son lives. So it was interesting, though. Jesus didn't go with him. He made him go home a whole day's journey so that he would have to believe him on the way home. But what he said to this man is so important to us today. Look in verse 48 of John 4. Jesus therefore said to them, unless you people see signs and wonders, you simply will not believe. Now, in John chapter 20, when Thomas came, he said, unless I see the wound in his hands and the wound in his side, I'm not going to believe that he's been raised from the dead. So Jesus appeared in John 20, verse 27. Then he said to Thomas, reach here your finger and see my hands. Reach here your hand and put it into my side, and be not unbelieving, but believing. And Thomas answered and said to him, my Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, because you have seen me, have you believed? More blessed are they who did not see and yet believed. You see, God's most important message to us is not to believe because we see signs and wonders, although he still does them. Sure he does. We see them happen in our church. But the emphasis in my church is never on that. Fact is, we had a split in the church because there was a guy who wanted a healing meeting every Sunday. I said, absolutely not, over my dead body. We have healings take place all the time, but we don't make that the feature of the church. You know what the feature of the church is? Teaching the Word of God, because that's what the Word of God says we should do. And the other is something that God does in His mercy. And sometimes people need that boost to their faith, but that's not the preferred way. Real faith believes something is true because God said so. Believing the promises of God because God said it. And that's real faith. That's why I wrote the book Combat Faith. It's the most important book I'll ever write, because it talks about what real faith is and how to claim the promises of God and how to fight spiritual combat every day. Now, a very important thing happened out here on this lake, and as many, many things, but I'd just like to refer to it. It's in Matthew 14, where Jesus had just turned a few loaves of bread and fishes into enough to feed probably about 15,000 people, because there were 5,000 men alone, plus women and children. So minimum 15,000 people. His disciples saw it. But you know what? He saw they didn't get the significance of it. They were all excited about the bread and the fishes. And so he deliberately told them to take a boat, go out on the lake to the other side, and he says, I'll join you later. He stayed. And they ran into one of those famous storms that David was talking about here. And believe me, I've seen them out here, and I'm an ex-tugboat captain. I've seen heavy storms, but nothing like out here. And so that storm started. It says, but Jesus stayed, and he went up in the mountain to pray. Let me ask you a couple of questions. Did Jesus know a storm was coming? Yes, he knew everything. Why did he send them out into the storm alone? Absolutely. And what do you think he prayed about? I can hear it now. Heavenly Father, will you teach those 12 knuckleheads what faith is? And will you not let their faith fail when the test comes? And he prayed for them. And these guys, you know, if there was anything that these men believed they could do, it was to be seamen. Because after all, what did they do? All but one of them had lived their life on this lake. They were fishermen. They knew this lake. And yet he saw to it that a storm came that was greater than they had ever seen before. And so the very thing that they thought they could do in their own strength best, they found they couldn't even do that. And God deliberately sent them into that situation. What's your storm today? What has God sent you into? It's the same. You see, I don't care what kind of a crisis you're in today. God allowed it. He sent you right into it. And not to crush you, not to make you unhappy, but to teach you the most important lesson of all, how to live above the storm. Because you see, Jesus came walking out to the 12 knuckleheads on the water. And you'll find that that's basically a good description of the 12 apostles throughout the Gospels. All they did was open their mouth to change feet. And I'm sure that God chose those guys so that we would all have hope that if he could do something with them, he could certainly do something with us. But Jesus came walking to them, and we read how Peter saw it. They were all afraid. Verse 26, Matthew 14, says, "And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were frightened, saying, 'It is a ghost,' and they cried out for fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, 'Take courage, it is I, do not be afraid.' And Peter answered him, saying, 'Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water.' And he said, 'Come.'" Now look, that's faith. Peter showed faith here. You know what his faith was? That if the Lord commanded him to do something, he would give him the power to do it. In other words, the Lord will never ask us to do something that he doesn't give us the power to do. For instance, if he asks us to go into all the world and preach the gospel, he'll give us the power to make the gospel clear and powerful. Now, we have to learn how to make it simple. Everybody does. I don't care if you got the gift of evangelism or not. You got to learn how to make the gospel simple. That's for you today. But it's God that gives the power. He commands us to do it. But Peter believed, and so the Lord said, "Come." And, you know, Peter got out of the boat. I'm sure he tested the water. He got one foot down. You know, he's, look. Held on with his hands, and then he put both feet down, and then he let go, and finally he's down to one finger. Then he let go, and he's, "Look, Lord, no hands," you know, and off he goes. What most of us fail to see is he did walk on the water at first. But, we read, in verse 29, Jesus said, "Come," and Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came toward Jesus. But seeing the wind, you know, the "but" or "nevertheless" is a word that always introduces a problem. But he was walking on the water, he was doing fine. But it says, "But seeing the wind, he became afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, saying, 'Lord, save me.' And immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and took hold of him and said to him, 'Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?'" Now, there are several things I want to point out here very quickly. First of all, don't you try to get out there and walk on the water. We had a woman one time. She couldn't swim. She got out. She was going to walk on the water. She was going down. We're trying to throw life vests to her. Everything else, she refused, almost drowned. She was sure she was going to walk on the water. And, you know, we finally had to fish her out. But you know why she did that? Why she sank? Because the Lord didn't command her to do it. The Lord commanded Peter to do it. In other words, you better know what God's will is before you go leaping off into foolishness. A lot of people act, you know, Fred Price et al. They act like you can command God around like he's a servant. Can't do that. You got to first ascertain what is God's will. Then you ask God to do it. If it's his will, he'll do it. It's a matter of just saying, "Hey, okay, Lord, I believe you. Do this. Do that." Yes, but you better know what his will is, specifically. So that's the first thing. But the most important thing is, why did Peter start sinking? You know, here he was, walking on top of the storm, with his looking at Jesus, believing as long as he looked at him that Jesus had more power than the storm. But it says, seeing the wind and the waves, what did he do? He took his eyes off of Jesus and put them on the problem. As soon as he looked at the problem, instead of looking at the problem solver, down he went. And you see, that's the most important thing for us to know today. I don't care what problem you've got in your life, how sincere you are about it. If you try to solve it, you're going to sink. Keep your eyes on the problem solver, not on the problem. Focus on him. That's why it says in Hebrews 12, looking off and away unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Keep looking off and away from all that distracts to him. Well, that doesn't mean stare at a portrait of Jesus. It means look in your heart to what the Bible reveals about him. That the way he walked is exactly the way we walk. All of his human life, he walked by faith, depending on the Holy Spirit to empower his human nature. We're to do the same thing. And we're to believe the promises of God. Whenever we have a problem, whatever storm is in your life, don't let it take you under. Walk on top of the storms of life by believing specific promises of God about the problem. There's a promise for every problem you can have. If you're afraid, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. Yes, I will uphold you, the right hand of my righteousness. Isaiah 41:10. I mean, you know, all of these things are second nature to me. I memorized these promises when I was in terrible storms at age 26. Saved my life. Literally saved my life. Learning to believe the promises of God. Learning to focus on the problem solver instead of the problem. And that's the great lesson I get out of this lake. And thank God, even when we fail, Jesus immediately reaches out and pulls us up. He may let us go into a storm. He may let us sink, but not permanently. Isn't that great? Praise the Lord. Let's go on and have lunch.
That we're building in the last 10 years, Everest is becoming a tourist center today, and people can really
We're never going to make it, huh?
Yeah.
One of the most important commands the Lord gave us, and that's the rite of baptism. For some of you, this is more of a commemorative thing because you've been baptized before. You simply want to do it in the Jordan. Well, that's all right. But everyone should be baptized after they have believed in Christ for salvation. If you were baptized as a baby, that was not a baptism, it was a submersion. It meant nothing, except that maybe it was a dedication. But baptism is for believers only, and it should be done after you have received Christ. But what that means is something that's very important to have in mind when you go to participate in this. And I want to draw attention to the fact that there are 7 different baptisms in the Bible. 7 entirely different baptisms. And what you're celebrating today is your testimony that you believe in your heart you were baptized at the moment you were saved by the real baptism, which was the baptism by the Holy Spirit. This is a picture of it that the Lord has commanded us to do as a testimony after that. And it is to be done with an understanding of what you're saying. This is your highest testimony to God that you believe that He has done something that cannot be reversed. Now I want to read from Matthew chapter 3, where we have 3 different kinds of baptism in 2 verses, just to draw attention to what we're saying here. In Matthew chapter 3, we read how that all people were coming out, of all walks, coming out to John the Baptist to hear him and to be baptized. And so, John the Baptist, it says, they were, in verse 6, they were being baptized by him in the Jordan River as they confessed their sins. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who has warned you to flee from the wrath to come?" Now, why did he say that? They were coming to be baptized. They were willing to be baptized, which is an amazing thing for Pharisees and Sadducees. But he wouldn't baptize them. That's right, because they were not believers. They came out to join in the crowd, but they were not believers. They knew he was a prophet, but they didn't believe his message. And so he refuses. And he said, "Therefore bring forth fruit in keeping with your repentance, and do not suppose that you can say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham for our father.' For I say to you that God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham." So he was reminding them that physical lineage from Abraham didn't save them. Many in Judaism taught that, you know, if you were physically related to Abraham, it would be impossible for Abraham to let you go into hell. And so they taught salvation not only by the law, but by descendancy from Abraham. And he said, verse 10, "And the axe is already laid at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. As for me," now listen carefully to this, "as for me, I baptize you with water for repentance. But he who is coming after me is mightier than I, and I'm not worthy to remove his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire." Okay? Now there are 3 different baptisms that I've talked about right here. There was a baptism of John the Baptist. There was a baptism that Jesus would effect with the Holy Spirit, and there was a baptism of fire that he would.
The truest baptisms I ever effected were when I was still in Campus Crusade for Christ, back in the good old days of the 60s, when it was a free-for-all on the campuses. We used to love to go up to Berkeley, University of California, Berkeley. And when somebody would trust Christ, we'd go to Ludwig's Fountain, right in the middle of the heart of the campus, right in the middle of all the student activity, all of the free speech platform, and we'd go out there and a guy would say, "I believe in Jesus Christ, He's my Lord and Savior," and we'd baptize him right there in Ludwig's Fountain. The Marxists, the SDS, everybody would go crazy. They'd try to get the they tried to get the ACLU there to stop it. Well, we'd do it anyway. But you see, that is true baptism, because they were they were testifying in front of all of their friends. Look, I've received Christ. It should be done in public places. You see? These little in-house things in the church. I'm not for that. We always baptize. You know, I used to have a church on the beach at Santa Monica. People magazine came and wrote it up one time. As I always baptized people in a wetsuit. We'd go right out there and it was really funny. Old O.J. Simpson used to come. A lot of other people. We'd baptize them right out there in the surf, and everybody would look. It was really, really a lot of fun. They used to speak with loudspeakers there, and of course there's the Pacific Palisades cliffs there. I never will forget one time, I saw this Rolls Royce pull up while I was speaking, and this very, very elegant lady got out of the Rolls Royce, and she had a white robe on, sort of a white, fancy terry cloth robe. And I had made a call, said, we're going to baptize. She comes out there, comes up to me, and she said, I came to be baptized. And I said, do you know what it's all about? She said, do I know what it's all about? Young man, she pointed up on the cliff. She says, you see that house up there? That's my house. And she said, I used to get so angry because this loudspeaker would ricochet off the walls up there. And she said, finally, I started listening. And she said, 3 weeks ago, I believed in Christ. And she said, I heard that you were going to baptize. So I thought, since I'm a believer, I might as well join those kooks. So she came down. And we baptized her right there in the surf. But you see, that is the proper thing. And its simplicity and its humor, that's what we're talking about. That's what it's all about. So let's prepare. And I want you to remember that this is your solemn testimony to God, that you believe that you're in union with Christ, that your life is so identified with Him that you have been put to death to the world and raised into a new life with Him. And the more you count that truth, the more the Holy Spirit will make it true. Because the Christian life is a matter of becoming what you already are. You already are everything you need to be. You just need to claim it. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for each one who now comes to give testimony of their faith in the work of the Holy Spirit in sealing them in Jesus Christ. And so right now, Father, we commit each one and we pray that this will be pleasing to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, if y'all will come down, all of you that are going to be... Yep.
Brother Hal. Brother Hal. Facing the... You know what? I forgot
about the picture. Okay, I'm going to go a little further out this way.
Where you come out of the tent, last one? Hi, what's the deal?
Yes. same time.
Come on.
Put your arms around each other. Hands on the ground. Now, okay. I want you to hold our hands in the middle. Bring them in the middle. Like this. Hold this way.
Did I have your towel?
Uh-huh.
I did.
Not yet.
Yeah.
Next.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Did you say this? How did you say this?
Oh, thank you. I thought you were going to be at the other end.
I know, I just realized you come out this side, though.
Yeah, thank you.
Good.
I don't think so. Let's come back over here because if you get too far out there, maybe it's going to be.
Did I have your title?
Okay.
I've been on the other side of the island. He's exactly that.
Hello.
Where's
my coffee?
Thank you. Do I? No, I have a bracelet on. I can go.
Thank you. Praise the Lord, huh?
Well, as you look out, you can see why Jesus loved this place. This was his favorite place in all the world, the Mount of Olives. He used to sleep at night over here under the olive trees. And the Mount of Olives, the Garden of Gethsemane, is just below us here. But he used to love to come up among the olive trees with his disciples and sleep there under the trees. It's because he could always behold the city. It's like a plan view from here, and they could always see the temple, God's house. And so this was a precious place, of course, to him, and I suppose to everyone else. But as you look over this city, Jerusalem, which means the city of peace, the ironic thing is that it's rarely ever been at peace. The Jebusites, descended from the Ammonites, first held this city. They were a very warlike people. They were backed up by the Anakim, which were the giants. And they were great warriors, and even Joshua and those who came after him could not liberate this city. And so when King David came along and he said that he was going to liberate this city, the Jebusites stood on the wall and laughed at him. Turn with me to Psalm 24. That David wrote after he liberated Jerusalem from the Jebusites. He was the first one to establish that city as the capital of Israel and make it holy for them. In verse 7, he chants what they had chanted as the Israeli army moved toward the city to war against it. He said, "Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in." And then he repeats the chant that the Jebusites hurled as an insult toward them. And that's the next verse. "Who is the King of glory?" And David and the army would answer, "The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates, and lift them up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in." And then he repeats the chant of the Jebusites, "Who is this King of glory?" And then they answer, "The Lord of hosts, he is the King of glory." And it was with that chant, "Lift up your gates and let the King of glory come in," that David led the first charge personally against this city. And David, with his own sword, was the first one to breach the wall. This was the beginning with thousands of years of an attachment to this city that will never die. From the time David conquered it until this present hour, it is the most precious place on earth to every Israelite. They don't even understand why it is such an emotional attachment, but it is as if it is their very heart. So when they were scattered from this country and they were barred from Jerusalem, they would risk anything to get back in. And the strange thing is that most of us don't realize that even after the destruction of the temple and Jerusalem in 70 AD, there was always a remnant of Jews who have been here. They have been massacred, they have been persecuted, they have been everything done to them, but there was always some who managed to cling by their fingernails to be in this city. They endured untold hardship, untold inhumanities, untold insults and so forth, but still they would stay here. And so when the Zionist movement started at the end of the last century, that was not the first time Jews were here. There were always some that at any cost would cling to this country, and especially to this city. There's never been any race of people that have been able to remain a distinct race of people after being destroyed twice as a nation, and the second time being scattered throughout the whole world, as the Jew has. And there's never been another people that has kept such an undying attachment to any place like they have for Jerusalem. And so as we look at this city, we look at a city that is the only one that God ever said, "My name is upon this city. It is my city." We're standing on the land that is the only land that God ever said, "This is my land." You know, as James Baker III keeps running back and forth talking to all of the Arabs who are only playing games with him anyway, and he talks about how to bring peace to this land, he fails to see that no man will ever solve the Arab-Israeli conflict, because the Arabs don't own this land and the Israelis don't own this land. God does. And God has predicted exactly how he's going to handle the ownership of this land. He threw the Jews out for disobedience, but in the same passages he predicted the destruction of Israel, he predicted their return just before the coming of the Messiah. a return in unbelief, yes, but a return that will result eventually in mass conversion here. So as we look at this city again, here is the city that over 3,000 years has been a center of controversy. Even when David and Solomon were here, there were wars. But since then, there have been many, many wars. Twice this city has been destroyed by foreign invaders, even when Israel had possession of it. The first obliteration of this city was by Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians. As predicted by Jeremiah and other prophets, the people were scattered away from this land and this city for exactly 70 years. And then, as they predicted, they were allowed to come back after 70 years captivity. Over a period of time, they rebuilt the city. But Moses and other prophets predicted they would a second time go into unbelief, and a second time they would be destroyed, and this city would utterly be destroyed in the second destruction, and the people would be scattered throughout the whole world. And so it was. The Roman 10th Legion, a legion that will live in infamy, led by Titus of Rome, destroyed this city in 70 AD. They later felt that it wasn't destroyed enough after the revolt that occurred afterwards, and they not only tore every stone down, but they plowed the whole temple area under with plows and everything else. And it resulted in exactly what Jesus said when in Matthew chapter 23, let us look, if you'll just hold it. Matthew chapter 23, after the most scathing indictment of unbelief of any people that's ever been preached to, Jesus said, in verse 36, "Truly I say to you, all these things shall come upon this generation." He was speaking about the religious leaders and the false teachings that they had given. And then he says in verse 37, "O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her, how often I wanted to gather your children together the way a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were unwilling. Behold, your house is being left to you desolate. For I say to you, from now on you shall not see me until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" So he pronounced, but notice when he pronounces judgment upon Jerusalem in the original Hebrew, which is by divine inspiration translated into Greek, he says, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem." It was pathos. It was with weeping, because he knew what would come. And he cried over this city. In fact, when he rode into it on that triumphal entry, as it is called, it says Jesus wept. Only in the original Greek, it says Jesus burst into uncontrollable sobbing. In Luke chapter 21, verse 20, Jesus has been rejected, and he says, "But when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then recognize that her desolation is at hand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let those who are in the midst of the city depart. Let not those who are in the country enter the city. Because these are the days of vengeance, in order that all things which are written may be fulfilled." See, the destruction of Jerusalem had been predicted. And Jesus predicts it again in detail. He says in verse 23, "Woe to those who are with child and to those who nurse babes in those days, for there will be a great distress upon the land and wrath to this people. And they will fall by the edge of the sword and will be led captive into all nations. And Jerusalem shall be trampled underfoot by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. How graphically that prophecy has been fulfilled. Jerusalem would be surrounded by armies. He was predicting the Roman army coming. He said that it would be destroyed, and he said that the city, the people would be scattered throughout the world. The city would be trampled underfoot until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. Blessed are your ears, because you live in the generation when the times of the Gentiles are almost fulfilled. We see it happening right now. What happens to Jerusalem is above everything else on earth God's time clock for His prophetic program. Jerusalem, more than anything else, what is happening to Jerusalem is God's time measure of where we are in His prophetic time clock. And so He said that it would be trampled underfoot by the Gentiles, and so it has. The Romans destroyed it. Then Bar Kokhba led a rebellion trying to take it back. They were utterly obliterated in 135 BC. Then for a while the Romans held to it, then the Roman Empire fell apart. Then the Mamelukes came. Then came the Muslims. First, at the beginning of the 600s, they came and they conquered the city from the Christians who held it. The Byzantine Christians held it until the beginning of the 7th century. The Muslims took it away from them. And there were many fights between various factions of the Muslims. And finally, the holy places began to be a burr under the saddle of the popes. For various reasons, they saw this was a way to unite the political states of Europe under their control. And so they came up with this idea of the Crusades, which was certainly not Christian, resulted in the most unchristian slaughter of people in history. But here came all of the Christian, so-called Christian knights of Europe, to liberate the holy places.